Let's prepare on chemical characteristics of water. Chemical characteristics of water. So the first characteristics we are going to see is total solids and the suspended solids. In the last class itself we have seen about the dissolved solids. So that dissolved plus suspended only will give your total solids. So we can find this total solids by just evaporating the water and weighing the dry residue that is left out. And if you want to find the suspended solids, means you have to filter the water and then you have to dry the residue of the water which is in the filter. So you can get the suspended solids by detecting this in the total solids. You can get the dissolved solids. The next characteristics is pH. So pH is the negative logarithm of your hydrogen ions. So if your hydrogen ions is more in your water, your pH will be less, and the vice versa. So when your hydrogen ions is more, your pH will be less, so that it is acidic in nature. So a limit is given, that is pH, when it is less than 7, it will be acidic, and when it is greater than 7, that means the H plus ions is very less. So it means that your water is, or your solution is alkaline. So an example is given. So this type of problem may be asked in the competitive exam. So it is just an example. An incoming water in a treatment plant is having a pH of 7.2, and the outgoing water of the same treatment plant is having a pH of 8.4. So you have to find the average value of the pH of the water. So this will be the question. So you have to find the average of the H plus ions first, then you can find the pH of that average water. Okay, so when the pH is 7.2, you can represent it as minus logarithm of H plus, and when it is 8.4, it is minus logarithm of the same H plus. Okay, so that only here we have written as H plus is equal to 10 power minus 7.2 and H2 plus is equal to 10 power minus 8.4. So when you are taking average for these both, you will get a value of 8.42 into 10 power minus 8.4. So this is the average H plus value. So with this you can find the average pH value. So the negative logarithm of this H plus will give you 7.4. So this is the average pH of the water in that treatment plant. The next is alkalinity and acidity. So these both are somewhat related to your pH. So based on that you can judge the acidity and alkalinity. So first is the alkalinity, and its range is 200. It is its desirable limit, and its permissible limit is 600. And the alkalinity are of three types: bicarbonate, carbonate and hydroxide or caustic. So if the water has the bicarbonate ions of calcium and magnesium, then it is bicarbonate alkalinity. If it has carbonates of sodium, potassium, calcium, magnesium of something, then it is carbonate alkalinity. If it is hydroxide, means we call it as caustic alkalinity or hydroxide alkalinity. And the next one is acidity. So here, if the water contains mineral acids, free carbon dioxide or sulfates of any iron or aluminium, then the acidic nature will be more for the water, so that the acidity will be increasing for the water. The next property is the hardness. So the hardness limit as per the IS code is 200, and its permissible limit is 600. So because of this calcium and magnesium salts only, this hardness is coming into the water. So here also there are two types, one is temporary and another is permanent hardness. So temporary is also called as carbonate hardness, because it is the hardness due to the bicarbonate and carbonates of calcium and magnesium. So this can be simply removed by boiling itself. Next one is permanent or non-carbonate hardness. So here it is due to the sulfates, chlorates and nitrates of the calcium magnesium salts. Okay, so this can be removed by softening methods only. It cannot be removed by simple boiling method. So the hardness is found out by EDTA method in our laboratories, and it is always expressed in the terms of calcium carbonate only. So you may think why the magnesium is not mentioned here, because calcium plays a predominant role in this hardness. So it is always expressed in the terms of calcium carbonate only. Okay, so how we can find the total hardness, carbonate and non-carbonate? So for finding the total hardness, first you have to know the calcium and magnesium concentration of that water. So when you know the calcium and magnesium carbonate, you can use this formula for finding the total hardness. So the calcium concentration in the water into 50 by 20. So what is this 50 by 20? It is the equivalent weight of CaCO3 divided by the equivalent weight of calcium. So for the equivalent weight of CaCO3 is 50 and for calcium it is 20. Here the same magnesium, it is 12. So we have given this formula. So with this you can find the total hardness. So if you want to find the carbonate hardness, the lesser of the total hardness or alkalinity has to be taken. So if you know the carbonate hardness, you can directly deduct it from the total hardness so that you can find the non-carbonate hardness. So that is total hardness minus carbonate hardness. So this is the basic concepts of the hardness. Now we can see an example for finding the total hardness and carbonate hardness of a water. So here an example is given. Here total alkalinity is 200 mg per liter of CaCO3 and the concentration of calcium is 120 and the concentration of magnesium is 60. So these are the three data are given here. So now we can find the total hardness. So the total hardness is equal to the calcium concentration, that is 120 into 50 by 20 plus 60, that is the concentration of the magnesium, into 50 by 12. So this will give you 550 milligram per liter of calcium carbonate. So now we have found out the total hardness. So the next is carbonate hardness. So here the carbonate hardness, it is the lesser of the total hardness and total alkalinity. So if you compare the value here, it is 550 and the total alkalinity is 200. So the lesser of the 550 and 200 is 200. So we can keep it as carbonate hardness. So when we are minusing this carbonate hardness from total hardness, you can get the non-carbonate hardness value as 350 milligram per liter. Okay. So this is a simple example for calculating the hardness and the relative terms. The next is the chlorate content. So the limit for the chlorate content as per IS code is 250 only and the permissible is 1000 ppm. So it is because of the sewage and industrial waste discharge into the river streams or something. So if the chlorate content is more in a raw water means, it means that the sewage is somewhere mixed to the raw waters. And it is found by silver nitrate titration with indicator as potassium chromate in our laboratories. The next characteristics is nitrogen content. So it is very important. The nitrogen content itself has many forms of nitrogen. Okay, so first we will see the free ammonia. So if the free ammonia is present in the water, it means that the water is recently polluted because it will be the starting stage of the decomposition. So its limit should be 0.15 milligram per liter only. And the next is albuminoid or organic nitrogen. So here it is the undecomposed organic matter. Mostly it will be in the form of the proteins and amino acids only. So it can be normally measured by the Jeddah nitrogen method. So if you are adding KMnO4 to that water and if you are boiling it, so that the vapors can be collected and it will give the direct reading of the free ammonia. So with respect to that, you can find both free ammonia and the organic nitrogen using this Jeddah method. The limit of this organic nitrogen is 0.3 milligram per liter only. And the third is nitrate. So this is the partly decomposed stage. So as it is partly decomposed, it should not be present in the water for the safety purpose. The fourth one is nitrate. So nitrate is a fully oxidized form of a nitrogen and this can cause blue baby disease, which is also termed as methemoglobinemia. Okay, so the limit of this nitrate should be 45 milligram per liter in the water. And the last one is the metals and the other substances. So we will see the various limit of various metals in the following. So the first is sulfate, so it is 200 to 400. Then the fluoride, it is 1 to 1.5. And here if it is less than 1, dental caries and cavity formation will be coming. And when it is greater than 1.5 milligram per liter, mottling and fluorosis will be coming. And the next is mercury phenol, it is 0.001 milligram per liter. Then lead, selenium, arsenic will have 0.01 and cyanide, chromium and H2S will be having 0.05. Copper, the limit is 0.05 to 1.5. Iron, it is 0.3. Silver, it is 0.1. Manganese, 0.1 to 0.3. Zinc, 5 to 15. Magnesium, 30 to 100. And the last calcium is 75 to 200. So here I have given some important metals alone. So it is all based on the IS code 10500-2012. So if you want to know the limits of various metals, you can refer to this IS code. Thank you and keep watching for the next lecture on biological characteristics of water.